So you're thinking about breastfeeding, or someone told you you should breastfeed, or you are breastfeeding and you've got questions and curiosities, and I understand, and maybe that's why you're here on this video. I just want to thank you for trusting me through my thumbnail and my title that I would give you some juicy information, because baby, it's about to be juicy. Okay, hey y'all, what's up? It's me, Miss Ruby. Welcome back to my channel, and thank you so much for stopping by to chit chat with me. For those of you who don't know, I am currently pregnant with my second child. I am a mother, I'm a wife, and I have been making YouTube videos for a long time. In this season, I have been blessed to be able to be at home a lot with my family, and so breastfeeding for me was definitely something that I wanted to do, but was also something that I was able to do. And so I want to start this video out by saying that it's not always an easy thing. I do think it is the most nutritious thing that we could do for our children. It dates back to the beginning of time, before all of these new inventions. Clearly, our bodies were created to be able to nourish our babies, which is why we produce milk as mothers. So I believe in it strongly for its holistic benefits. But at the same time, you know, with the era that we live in, the society that we live in, I feel like we are constantly expected to work, be busy, wear a million different hats. And for some of us, that really challenges us in the area of being able to breastfeed. So don't beat yourself up if you are not currently breastfeeding, but I would highly encourage you to educate yourself and be open-minded to fighting through the challenges, because honestly, it seems like a lot of the people who I encounter who fail at breastfeeding, or it's not really a failure, but you know, who try and it just doesn't work out, is really because they don't really have all of the information, and they don't know enough people who have experiences that they can glean from. Okay, so let me get started. In this video, I want to talk to you guys about my breastfeeding experience, specifically being a breastfeeding mother after having a C-section. I have not done my C-section experience video yet, but I am doing it really, really soon. So stay tuned for that, and let me know in the comments below if you have any questions regarding that. So my first baby currently is just over 2 years old, and I did breastfeed her for 15 months. I talked about this in other social media posts. So if you guys don't follow me on Instagram, definitely follow me there, because I kind of like post little updates about my pregnancy journey and stuff like that. You know, before getting pregnant though, I didn't know that much about breastfeeding. Honestly, growing up, I always saw everyone using formula. I actually liked the smell of formula, and I was looking forward to having a baby and making the little baby bottles and shaking them up and feeding my baby. I always thought that's just how you fed babies. Obviously, as I began to get older, I would notice that some women would have their boobs out and be nursing their babies, but I just didn't think much of it. I guess I thought it was abnormal. I didn't think it was like bad, good. I just didn't think anything of it. And come closer to the time period where I was becoming a mother, I had multiple friends and relatives that were also having kids, and they were breastfeeding, and they were learning a lot about breastfeeding, and they were passing the information along to me, and I got to see them breastfeeding their children, and I started to think more about it and realize that I'm this person who really values the natural approach, the most simplistic mother nature approach. What were we designed to do, and how do we activate our very best selves, right? And so I learned that breast milk has everything that a baby needs without like having to worry about buying a certain type of formula. Like, my milk is gonna be specifically you know, generated by my body to support the growth needs of my baby. The most that I may have to worry about is an allergy, like a food allergy that my baby may have to something I'm eating, because sometimes it does transfer through to the milk. But I done seen some babies go through, you know, extreme gassiness and constipation because of drinking the wrong formula, and I always was concerned about that. So when I found out that breast milk is natural, and first of all, it's free, okay, baby. So I'ma let y'all know right now, breastfeeding was not easy for me at first. It took a while. So if you're currently struggling, then just know that you are not alone, boo, because this thing is not for the faint of heart at all. Right after having my unexpected C-section, I was thinking that I was getting ready to get some rest, right? I was pumped up with all of this medicine that had me extremely drowsy and nauseous. The baby was finally out of me, so I'm like, okay, cool, I can finally go to sleep. They kind of like, you know, roll me into this other room outside of the surgery room, and I'm starting to fall asleep. And then next thing you know, they come and they plop the baby on me. And I was looking like, what y'all doing? And she's like, she's hungry, it's time to nurse. And I was like, oh my gosh, I just had her, it's already time to feed her. Like, didn't she get food when she was inside of me? I had no idea, y'all. So literally, like, I felt like there was probably a 10 to 15 minute lapse of time between when she came out my belly and when she was breastfeeding, okay? So anyway, needless to say, I had to adjust real quick. Good thing about it was They like sat the baby close to my breast, but not directly on my nipple because they want the baby to initially find the nipple. And so she did really well. She was real hungry, y'all. Like, she didn't need no help. And I don't know if it was the way I was laying or what, but she latched right on and she started eating. And I felt like she fed for like 20 minutes because I did fall asleep. Like, I positioned my arm, I'm not even gonna lie. And I fell asleep. And so, yeah, I felt like, ooh, that was a good experience. Okay, this is about to be a walk in the park. Boy, was I wrong. So after that, I eventually get rolled into another room, and this is like the room that I'm gonna be just like, you know, in for a couple days as I recover. And, you know, I have my baby close to me and it was all good. I really didn't know what the schedule for breastfeeding was going to be like, so I was kind of just asking them. And it was just kind of like a whirlwind because I'm recovering from a C-section, okay? So I'm not exactly in pain because the heavy pain meds were still in me, but I was also not fully alert. And so I was just pretty much doing whatever they told me to do. And they said, how's the baby doing? Did the baby eat again? Is the baby hungry? Pay attention to the baby's cues. When the baby starts to cry or move their mouth a certain way, that might mean that she's hungry. So I just was winging it, basically. So I would say that the first day, like half a day, because I had my baby like a 3-something in the afternoon. So I would say for the remainder of that day, it was pretty straight. I felt like everything was going good. I wasn't really sure what it was supposed to feel like, but you know, your first day, you don't really have milk yet. You just have colostrum, so you don't really feel full or engorged. You don't really feel the milk coming out. So I felt like she's latching on. It seems like she's fine, and then she'll finish and she'll go to sleep. So we was all good. And then I started to feel like she was struggling a little bit to get what she needed, but I wasn't sure. And the next morning, it was like she was crying, like crazy, and I was worried, and I was like, I don't know what's going on. And then the nurses came to look at her, and they could pretty much tell by her facial like expressions and her mouth movements that she was hungry. And like I think when like they put like my finger in her mouth or something, they could tell by how she was acting that she was really, really hungry. And I'm like, well, I don't know, it seems like she's been feeding regularly, it seems like she would be all good. And they're just like, no. So then they were like, you know, have you hand expressed to see if you're getting anything coming out? And I'm like, no, I don't know what that is. And I was real stressed at this time. I was like, look, I don't know, I'm trying, this isn't working. Can we just supplement with milk for right now? I'm recovering, all I really wanna do is sleep. This is taking a lot out of me. You know, I'm gonna breastfeed, but can we just give her a little bit of bottle, you know, formula right now? And they were like, absolutely not. So I was at a hospital that strongly advocates for breastfeeding. And if you tell them you wanna breastfeed, then they're gonna do everything in their power to make sure it happens for you. And so one of the things that they say is that, you know, in the first like month, you don't really want to introduce a bottle or formula to a baby that you expect to be exclusively breastfed because it can confuse them. And it can make them lazy because bottles tend to get the milk out quicker, where they have to work harder when they're latched onto the breast, as well as the, you know, flavor, the taste, everything is just different. And so they did everything in their power not to, like literally the nurse came in there and was literally hand expressing milk or colostrum out of my boob. I'm like halfway between tears and being asleep, and she's trying to encourage me. She's like, oh look, you know, I know it doesn't seem like a lot, because it didn't seem like a lot, okay? It was like half of a centimeter of an ounce. Anyway, she's like, but this is a lot of colostrum, like you're doing really good. A lot of new moms. She had other like nurses coming in to help me with different stuff, and they're all looking, and she's like, isn't this good, guys? Like everyone's congratulating me, and I'm just like, okay. Thank you. So anyway, you know, went around in circles with that for a little bit. She basically hand expressed as much colostrum out of my boobs as she could. And then she put it inside of this little syringe. And then she kind of just dropped little drops in my baby's mouth. And I thought, there's no way that this could be doing anything for this baby. But when you first start breastfeeding, for the first few days, the baby doesn't really eat a lot. They actually had like this printout where they literally showed me like, day one, baby's gonna drink X amount of ounces per feeding. It wasn't even like ounces, it was like milliliters or something. Day two, it will increase a little bit. By day three, a little bit more. And then, you know, I think it took like a week or two for the baby to get to like a normal amount of feeding, like an ounce per feeding or something like that. So I was like, okay, this doesn't really make sense, but what they were doing was working. Like they were pouring it into the baby's mouth and she was calming down. So I was like, dang, that's crazy. I'm so happy that I had this help. And so then after that, they were just like showing me how to breastfeed. They're like, listen, the baby is connected to you and she's sucking on you, but she's not actually pulling milk from your boob, and that's why you're getting confused. So I'm like, what? So they literally had to show me how to hand express, which is not It's harder than it looks. If you've ever seen somebody do it, trust me. It's very like technical. And then the next day, I think an actual lactation specialist came to see me and literally sat me down and was like, let me see you breastfeed your baby. And it was kind of weird, but she's like, let me see what you do. And she saw like, okay, your arms need to be positioned a different way. You might need to sit a pillow up underneath you like this, hold the baby in this way. And then there was this thing that I wasn't expecting at all that she told me to do to my baby, which I felt was borderline child abuse, but it worked. She said, you gotta grab the baby's head and you have to basically jam their face into your boob, like literally, like because they don't really understand how important it is to get like this really big like latch onto your, you know, areola. And so I'm like, okay, it was so weird, y'all, but I'm not lying. It was effective. At first, my baby was literally just sucking from my nipple. And the baby needs to get a latch to the point where you can't really see your areola anymore. And I didn't really, like, they told me that at first, but I didn't really grasp the concept till this lady literally came and was helping me smash my baby's head into my boob. Like, it was crazy. But that helped so much. I was extremely exhausted at this point, like I said, still recovering through this C-section, you know, on these like pain meds. They're not leaving me alone. It's like a back-to-back every hour checking on me for all these different things. So I was in a horrible state, but it was a great relief to be at a place where my baby was finally getting some milk. And so that was the first like 2 days in the hospital, and by the second and a half day, I think it was time for me to go home. Now, when I was leaving the hospital, I still felt like there were so many things wrong with me. Things like I was still figuring the breastfeeding thing out. It was a relief that I had made an improvement, but I still hadn't gotten to a point where I felt fully comfortable to go home without having assistance. And they were like, look, long story short, you gotta go, boo. So I literally cried on my way out of that hospital, y'all. Like, cried holding my baby because I didn't know what I was gonna do. And, you know, got home and I ended up supplementing with milk because I was trying to do everything that they were telling me. But this is where I was in this stage, and I think a lot of women probably go through this, where you go through this stage after day two or three and your milk has not come in yet, and you're just feeling like there's just not enough colostrum anymore. Because like I told you, the baby's needs increase by the day, like every like half a day, honestly, the baby needs a little bit more and a little bit more. And I just felt like my colostrum was not enough. I was literally on all fours, y'all, trying to hand express and get as much colostrum out as I possibly could so I could feed my baby through a syringe. But it was discouraging to see these little tiny drops in the bottom of this cap. And I couldn't feel confident that was gonna feed my baby. So I supplemented with a little bit of that like newborn milk they give you, just poured a little bit in so I could feel like my baby was actually getting nourished. And yeah, I cried about it then. I felt really bad about it, but I got over it eventually. And by like day three and a half or four, my milk officially came in. I had her on the 12th, and by the 17th was the first time I was actually able to pump a good amount into a bag, okay? So that's a 5 day difference. I think my milk came in by day four. So yeah, when my milk came in though, let me tell you, that's not for the faint of heart. It's just not, okay? So many things changed. So we're now like, let's just say we're in week one officially being at home breastfeeding post C-section, okay? By this time, the medication from the hospital has worn off and now I'm on pills, and I have to stay super on top of my pills because the pain in my area down there, like, you know, where they did the incision, was ridiculous. I'm still managing blood flow because, you know, you're still bleeding after having a baby, and your energy is just completely gone because I never got sleep, but my labor was crazy. You guys will hear that story. So all of these things on top of trying to position the baby, right? Trying to pay attention to when the baby's hungry, having no idea absolutely at all, but trying to figure it out. And then, you know, kind of being in that in-between stage. So when my breast milk finally came in, it was like a big flip. I went from feeling discouraged that I didn't have enough and am I gonna be able to do this, to all of a sudden having an oversupply. And the reason why I had an oversupply, and this is why I feel like women should be able to stay in the hospital, breastfeeding moms at least, to stay in the hospital long enough for their milk to come in, because so much changes, and if you don't have proper instruction in these moments, you could just make your situation worse. As soon as my milk came in, I started pumping way too early. Now, I always had this idea that I wanted to be one of those moms who pumped extra milk and had like a freezer full of milk that I could donate to people or possibly sell or just have on hand for backup needs for myself, right? So pumping was definitely in the cards, but I didn't know I was gonna start pumping that soon. It was way too soon. Because I started pumping, I started producing even more. And so those first few days of my milk coming in, maybe like first couple weeks were a nightmare because I'm trying to figure out how to relieve this pain, how to feed the baby, what she likes, what position, you know, how not to have too much going into her mouth. It was crazy. But because I was pumping, I was pouring it in a bottle, like it's not advisable. And my husband was helping me with feeding her as I kind of just did research, asked my friends, and tested things out. And that's why, you know, I really wanted to share this because a lot of us give up at this stage. We feel like this is not working for me. Either I don't have enough, I have too much, it's too painful, it's too inconvenient, and we give up. But I will tell you that thank God I had a strong support system. And I strongly encourage you, if you're thinking about breastfeeding, get you a support system of some sort. Any sort. There's so many resources out there. I'll link some resources in the description of this video. There are resources, places that you can call and get guidance. There are so many videos you can watch just like this. But hopefully you have a friend or a relative who's been through it who can tell you, because it's those little things that you just don't even think to ask about. I would be hitting my friends up at 3 o'clock in the morning. Thank God they had all just had babies, so we was all up all night you know, struggling. But they were further than me on this breastfeeding journey, and they were able to tell me like, oh, you know, maybe you need to sit like this, or maybe you need to like keep her on longer. Maybe it's, you know, maybe you think she's full, but she's not actually full. You know, check her diapers, see what her poop's like. You know, check her stomach. Is it hard? Check her hands. Are her hands opening and closing? And, you know, this is how you know if they're full. There's like all these little cues, you know what I'm saying? And I'm like, okay. This, like I said, it took a good like 2 or 3 weeks for me to like sort this out. And during this time, I noticed that my baby had a white tongue. Now, at first I thought that was normal. She's drinking milk, she has a white tongue. So for the first few weeks, it wasn't too alarming. But a few weeks after that, her tongue was staying like really, really white. And so people started asking me like, does she have thrush? And I'm like, what is thrush? So then I find out about this whole thing called thrush, and I'm telling y'all about it just in case y'all babies get it. So thrush, just to keep it simple, is like this, I don't know, fungus in the mouth or something like that, that the baby gets, I think, through your breast milk or vice versa or whatever, but y'all pass it back and forth to each other basically. And so what tends to happen with babies that officially do have thrush, I think it's like an oversupply of yeast or something through your milk supply or something like that. And an indication they have it typically is that not just their tongue is white, but their gums on the inside are like white, and they're starting to get like this white, almost like cakey looking, you know, substance inside of their mouths all over. And you can tell that they have it because they're constantly in pain, especially when they breastfeed and you're in pain. And so I started to worry like, oh no, what is thrush? So now I'm just like, now I'm sidetracked looking into all this thrush stuff on top of trying to figure out just how to maneuver as a new mom in every aspect. So I remember there was this one time I had scheduled a doctor's appointment, and again, making new mommy breastfeeding mistakes, I went to the doctor's appointment. It was down the street from my house, but nonetheless, it was still away from my baby. I did not take my baby with me. I'm thinking, you know, she feeds every 2 hours. I'm gonna leave right after I feed her. I should be back for her next time where it's time to feed. I did not take a pump with me. I didn't take anything with me. So I'm at this doctor's appointment, which ended up lasting longer than I expected. I'm like waiting for the doctor to come in. My boobs are in pain, and now I'm getting engorged, and I have no baby there with me, no pump there with me to release this pain. So I was literally in the doctor's office crying in pain and feeling like a sucky mom, because what the heck is going on? My baby's got thrush. You know, I got all this pain, I got all this milk, I don't want to throw the milk away. And that was the first time that I actually had to just get rid of milk. I literally went inside the sink in the doctor's, like, you know how you go in the doctor's room, you're like in the private room and there's a sink in there. And I was literally in there hand expressing. By this time I had the hand expression down, hand expressing my boobs until I could get enough relief to be not so much in pain and be able to get through this doctor's appointment. So by the time the doctor came in with the nurse, you know, I was like, still kind of had tears in my eyes, and I'm talking to them about all my symptoms, and he's, you know, looking at my boobs and asking me questions, and pretty much concluded that I did not have thrush and the baby did not have thrush. And so that whole thing was a waste of time, energy, and very embarrassing and very painful. So that's when I learned how important it is as a breastfeeding mom who pumps, you don't ever leave your house without your baby or your pump. Ideally have your baby, because later on down the line, you'll learn that your baby is the absolute best relief. But anyway, thank God my baby didn't end up having thrush and I was able to just move on and continue to learn how to get this schedule down with feeding her. Okay, this was a long journey for me because I was pumping, like I said, and I pumped for quite a while because I did have this idea that she was gonna eventually take a bottle. And after she was a month old, I was more comfortable really trying to get her to take the bottle because I'm like, okay, they said wait till she a month. Okay, she a month, so let me like really try because I need to have this regimen. And long story short, my baby never actually ended up taking a bottle. She took it a couple times in the very, very beginning because she was just that hungry. But once we got accustomed to this situation of her feeding from me every 2 to 3 hours, she wasn't worried about no bottle at all. And I know people are like, oh, try this bottle, try that bottle, try all these different methods. And I really feel like I tried a whole lot of different things. And it wasn't happening for her. I wasn't comfortable. I wasn't comfortable with the amount of crying and all that. And maybe that's a journey in itself. So I can't teach you guys that. Because maybe if you really, really need to transition your baby to a bottle, there are some things you're going to have to fight through and you're going to have to accept. And then, you know, you and your baby will adjust. But I wasn't willing to adjust. So eventually, I just stopped, or I slowed down on pumping. Another thing I wanted to point out to, you know, have in mind, you have this fantasy that you're gonna get good sleep, especially if your baby doesn't sleep in the bed with you, right? Yeah, I knew I'd be waking up every few hours to feed her, but I figured the few hours in between, I'd be able to actually sleep. That was a fallacy. And the reason why is because your boobs are still producing milk. And the most comfortable position for me to sleep is on my belly. I was looking forward to delivering my baby and finally being able to sleep on my belly. And okay, my belly, like after 2 or 3 weeks of recovering from my C-section, my belly was more comfortable, but my boobs were constantly engorged and sleeping on my belly was just not happening. Okay, so just keep that in mind. You might still have to be sleeping on your side, and sleeping on your back is still relatively uncomfortable as well, just because the weight of the boobs being so different than what you're used to. That's what I experienced. So I still had to sleep on my side most of the time. And it took a very long time, months, probably like 6 months into the whole breastfeeding game, before my breasts really only produced enough to feed her at the exact time she was going to eat. I will say like three to six months into it, definitely 3 months into it, I was like good. Like I kind of had it down. Like, yeah, there were some things that I knew I was going to have to accept that weren't comfortable, but I definitely had the whole breastfeeding thing down to where I, you know, could go somewhere and just not have to think about it, cover my baby up, put her on my boob. I kind of understood what came with it, you know, how to burp her properly. I never had so much supply that I leaked through and soaked my breast pads. So I didn't actually use them that much. I was never one of those women who like had like leakage that was so extreme that it was like filling up breast pads. So that is something you may have to look out for if you are extremely oversupplying like that. Another thing when it comes to, came to the discomfort of my boobs, I know I'm kind of all over the place, but this is something for you to really like take note of too, is that when you're figuring the whole thing out, baby's struggling to latch on and you're struggling and you're kind of forcing things and then you're squeezing out milk out of your boobs and you're doing all these things, your nipples start to get really dry and cracked. It's a whole experience, okay? Everybody goes through this, okay? Some people get to the point where they're bleeding, depending on if the baby is latching correctly or not. Because when the baby doesn't have a correct latch, if a baby has like a tongue tie, a lip tie, or just something going on with them that they're not properly latching, it can cause both you and baby pain. So those are things to look into. Thank God my baby didn't have any of those extreme situations, but I still experienced dryness, a little bit of cracking and all that stuff. And so the hospital sent me home with that Lanesun, whatever, however you pronounce it, nipple cream, which did its job. But after a while, you have to decide, do I want to keep buying this? Or is there something more natural I could do? So two natural solutions could be coconut oil, which I was told that is something that relieves, you know, the dryness. It also provides that area with, you know, nutrients and stuff from the coconut oil, and it's edible by the baby, because babies tend, even if babies like have a nut allergy, they're far less likely to be allergic to coconut. So it's something to consider. Or you can just pump out some extra milk and rub it all over, because your milk is full of vitamins and nutrients, which help to restore the broken, dead, dried out cells that are causing your nipples to be like that. So it might not seem like an oily enough substance, but I did notice that if I didn't have access to my coconut oil, I would just, you know, rub my nipples down with my breast milk, and they eventually like cleared up and they pretty much stayed soft for the rest of the term of me breastfeeding. So to speed things up, I would say those first 3 months strong are like such a journey of learning. After that, things started to kind of clear up. Probably wasn't until about 6 months where I was able to sleep more comfortably and be fully regulated. And by a year into the breastfeeding experience, I felt like I wanted to wean my baby because I never planned on breastfeeding past a year. So at 11 months, I decided to start the weaning process. And I would just say, long story short, I guess I could make a separate video on like how I weaned my baby. But long story short, I started weaning her at 11 months, went through a whole experience weaning my baby of things that I didn't expect. And it wasn't until she was about 15 months that she was officially off of the breast. That is, in summary, my breastfeeding experience. I'm sure I left some things out. So if you guys have questions about anything, just ask in the comments below and I'll fill in the gaps, okay? Thank you so much for stopping by, for listening to me ramble. I hope you guys enjoyed the pictures and the videos. I hope you guys come back for more videos. God bless you. Remember to be you. Love you. Make it all beautiful. And baby, if you are thinking about breastfeeding, do not let anybody discourage you. It is the best thing that you can do for you and your baby. Do your research. Links are listed in the description of this video. And if for whatever reason you don't want to breastfeed your baby, also don't let anybody make you feel horrible about that. But I would strongly encourage you to, you know, at least try. At least try. At least try. Thank you so much. God bless you. See you next time.